It's possible to act from decisions. It's possible. But as we are, we act mechanically, without consciousness. This is really what mechanically means, is without consciousness. When it comes to our reactions, there's no effort involved. There's no effort to balance, weigh. It's just more of a reaction. It's just more of something that just happens because something has pressed a button. The problem is that most of our decisions are not ours. They don't belong to us. We don't own them. We didn't make them. We didn't build them. We didn't struggle. We didn't make effort to come to the conclusions. We basically inherited them through our false personality, which was built up by the people around us in life, the other sleeping people. We came into this world somewhat alert, somewhat awake, and then through our contact with other sleeping people, we learned how to sleep. We learned how to imitate. We learned how to march. We learned how to get in line. We learned how to be a part of it all so that we didn't stand out, so that we could survive. All of our decisions were unconsciously accepted by us. As we begin to observe ourselves properly, we begin to long to be different. That's the first sign of this work acting on someone. They begin to be dissatisfied with what they are. In life, it's easy to be dissatisfied with what you have or what you don't have. But in this work, you begin to be dissatisfied with what you are, what you bring to life. It doesn't matter what you have. That becomes all pointless, all meaningless. What becomes meaningful to people who allow this work to work in them, to change them, to rearrange them, to operate on them at a deep inner level, what happens to them is they begin to be dissatisfied with what they are, with who they are, with how they react to things, with what they have, with what their machinery, with what their programming is about. And they're no longer satisfied with how they interact with life and people in life, how the events of life fall on them, where they fall on them, what they do to them, what they bring out of them. We long to react differently to the events passing by in life. Have you learned to long to react differently? You just don't want to keep reacting that way. Have you gotten to the point where you're so tired of hurting people? Where you're so tired of being a coarse, violent, stupid, thick, obnoxious individual? A being who just goes through life slicing every soft underbelly around you, without ever even knowing that you did it. It's like somehow in our sleep, we grew razor blades on our elbows and on our knees and on our shoulders and on every part of our body. And we walk through a crowd and people bleed. And it's that we need to see about ourselves. It's that we need to understand, that it's that is causing the misery on this planet. We see the damage we've done. We see the damage that we do. We begin to see the damage that we will do if we go unchecked, undecided, unconscious, which is what we are. We are unchecked. And this work is to check us. We are undecided. Why? Because we never came to any conclusions. We never made any effort. We never did anything. We never measured and weighed. We never woke up enough to look and see what it was happening in us and in our world. It was too easy to just accept whatever was flowing down the river toward us. Decisions made without proper knowledge range from worthless to extremely dangerous. Think about some of the decisions that you've made. I'll never speak to that person again. Whoa! Man, there's a 100-watt bulb went on, huh? That's a really smart one. I'll never speak to that person again. I don't want anything to do with you. Great. Good decision. Think about those decisions. They're really going to bring you closer to your goal. Well, what is your goal? Well, my goal is to be conscious. To be conscious of what? That you're a hateful, antisocial person? Well, how long do you think you can stay conscious of that? How long do you think it's going to be that you're conscious of that, that you're going to want to go back to sleep? Well, just look at your life. You'll see that it's not long. You start to see that, and the first thing you want is some kind of anesthesia, something to dull that, something to make that fade back into the mush of life, the gray of life. We don't like to see that. We don't like to see the points. We want something to just swallow that up again. To whom do you go for counsel when making a decision? To the nursery, to preschool, to kindergarten, to grade school, to junior high, to high school, to college? Where do you go? Do you go back to when you were 3 years old, when you were 5 years old, when you were 8 years old and something happened to you in school, when you were 2 years old and your brother hit you over the head with a truck or whatever? Where do you go to make your decisions? I think you'll find if you look that that's where you go. You go so far back, it's frightening. And when you think about that child making those decisions, that's even more frightening. And you think about that child making those decisions, you wouldn't go to a nursery school today. You wouldn't go to a bassinet with a major decision in your life and say, well, what do you think I should do to the baby in there? Okay, that's what I'll do then. It's insane. Yet we do it all the time. We don't know because our so-called waking state is sleep. Where we go for counsel is where we get our fuel. And our fuel determines how we operate. It determines at what speed we operate. And what speed we operate is determined by in what center we operate. And what center we operate in is dependent upon the fuel that we use. If we use fuel that's thick and heavy and slow, it can only be used by a center that's thick and heavy and slow. If we want the influence of higher centers, if we want the action of higher centers in our lives, we have to learn to get a higher fuel so that we can feed those higher centers, make contact with those higher centers, and fall under the influence of their actions. Makes sense, doesn't it? Higher centers are fully functional. They're talking to us constantly. They're constantly counseling us. But we don't understand them because we can't hear them. We can't hear them because we are so far down in this mud, in this oatmeal of unconscious life. Of walking, waking, sleep. We just don't hear it. Last Monday was a good example. Somebody said something and they looked around and it was like everyone else just kind of was like, oh man. And they went, I've offended. And hadn't a clue. Had no clue of what was offensive. What could possibly be offensive in what I said? They're all nuts. These people are crazy. How could they not understand me? And that's our condition. We go through life slicing and dicing without ever knowing that we did it. What? What's the matter with you? Why are you bleeding? Stop bleeding on my floor. Quit bleeding on my clothes. Stop that. What's the matter with you? Never understanding you did it. In your sleep, you did it. And in your sleep, you stay oblivious to it. Because the fuel that you're burning is so coarse, so slow, that you can't get out of this center, this torpid center. And what is that torpid center? Well, no, actually, that's instinctive center, very quick. Thank you, Diana. The intellectual center is the slowest center that we've got. In our sleep, we lack the quickness of inner perception, the quickness of a higher level of consciousness that would help us to register finer meanings that the higher centers give. See, higher centers are full. They're rich with higher meaning. It's a tapestry. For you ladies who are into thread counts in sheets and pillowcases, let's get extravagant with thread counts. How about it?
What's it? 600.
600, 1,000. So there are thread counts of 1,000. What that means is the threads, the cotton threads, are so fine that they can pack more of them into a smaller area. And so the feeling is one of softness and luxury and fineness that you don't find in coarser things. Look at the difference between 600 thread count and burlap. Which would you rather have on your skin? Okay, well, yeah, there are some people who itch all the time and want the burlap. All right, fine. Burlap's for you then. That's fine. Those people are living at a lower level. What does that mean? Does that mean those people are not as good? No, those people just live at a different level. This work is for people who wish to live at a higher level, who wish to find the finer meanings of life, who have come to the point where they no longer believe in life. They no longer believe that life is an end in and of itself, that there has got to be something more. They sense in themselves that there is something finer, something richer, something better, something more, and they want it, but they don't know what it is. But they're willing to work to get it if someone will just teach them how to work. And that's what this work is about, to teach you how to work, to teach you how to learn how to perceive, how to look at yourself, how to see who and what you have become, what this world has made of you, and how to change that into something else, how to go from a coarse, crusty, burlap piece of cloth to 1,000 thread count, or to silk, or to cashmere. What is it that makes cashmere different than other wool? The fineness of the hairs. The finer they are, the softer they are, because the more of them there are. It's like the difference between the hair on your head and wire. The finer hair is, the softer it is. Sleep has made us thick and slow. We lack high enough fuel to move faster. Essentially, in life, we play the tortoise to the hare. The difference with us is we have the arrogance of the hare instead of the humility of the tortoise. The tortoise knew it wasn't fast. It knew it had to just continually keep on. It knew it couldn't rest. It knew that it was so slow, that it was so far behind, that it was so humble compared to the hare, that it could not stop. It could not rest. It could not relent. It had to continue. The difference between us and the tortoise is we have the arrogance of the hare. We think that we're so wonderful that the race will just be given to us just because of our sheer beauty and wonderfulness. And we're filled with this arrogance, this pride and vanity, filled to overflowing. And so we're blinded by that. Blinded to what? Blinded to how coarse we are and how slow we are and what a ridiculous parody we are. And this is why our lives are the way they are. This is why there are so many people around us who are hanging their heads because of things that we say and do. And we're getting angry with them because they don't understand us. Actually, they understand us just fine. It's we who do not understand ourselves. And that's the rub. It's like, but no, it can't be that. Yes, but it is that. They understand you just fine. You're the one who doesn't understand you. You need to bring your perception in alignment with theirs. But then I'd be a horrible monster. Okay. Well, we got to start where we are. But then I'd be this burlap scarecrow. Well, you got to start where you are. But I don't want to be there. Well, this work isn't about what you would like it to be, what you'd want to be. This work is about what's so, where you actually are. Because that's the only place from where you can move. You can't go anywhere from where you imagine that you are. You've got to start where you actually are. It's tough giving up the pride and the vanity. If we could work with the speed of emotional perception, hydrogens 24 and even 12, new meaning and insights would result. Surely you understand this because you have had this experience. You have experienced being able to understand things that you can't understand at other times. There are times when you understand the meaning of unity. You understand the meaning, or at least a higher meaning, of love. You understand the meaning of peace. You understand the meaning of equanimity. You understand the meaning of brotherly love. There are times you have to admit, they may be few and far between and maybe brief, but there are times when something inside of you reaches so high that it knows that that's the way you need to live, that that is a better life. The problem is we've given up on the idea that we can ever reach it. And so we say, well, we need world peace. Oh, world peace isn't the answer. World peace is not going to give you what you need. If the whole world is at peace and you are at war with yourself in your own heart, world peace is worthless. And world peace can't happen until people individually within themselves find peace. And that's not going to happen until we start to reconcile the opposites inside of us. The side that we will not acknowledge. The side that hurts people. The side that doesn't care for people. The side that only cares for itself. We have to begin to include that in our estimation of ourselves. We've got to begin to see that and to see its actions. This is an unpleasant task, which is why people would rather sleep. I don't blame them. I don't blame me when I want to sleep. It's just that I'm afraid to sleep. It's not that I'm afraid of the boogeyman. I know the boogeyman will get me when I sleep. It's not that I think he might. I know he will, because that's the only time he can get me, is when I'm asleep. And isn't that true for all of us? When is it that false personality and the coarse, dark side of us takes over? When we're asleep. It doesn't happen when we're awake. Like one of the kids said to their mother, mother said, what were you thinking? Well, that's just it, Mom. I wasn't thinking. But that was a rare moment of awareness when the child realized I wasn't thinking. I was being an idiot. And those are rare moments for us because we spend so much time in this hypnotism of life, in this sleep, in this walking, waking sleep, that we don't see what we do, what we've become, where our actions will lead us. Because the formatory part of the intellectual center operates on slow, heavy fuel, which of course is hydrogen 48, the higher centers burn higher fuels, and without the higher fuels, the higher centers are functionally dead to us. But since we have such an abundance of hydrogen 48, we can be burning that fuel all the time. So you see, the formatory apparatus, the formatory part of the intellectual center, it's functioning all the time. It is where we live. Why is it where we live? Because that's what fuel we have. Okay, so here it is, winter here in the United States, and people are heating their houses. What are they using to heat their houses? Well, some people are using wood. Some people are using electricity. Some people are using natural gas. Some people are using liquid propane. few people, I'm sure, using cow dung. Even fewer are using camel dung. The huge shortage of camels here in Southern California. But in other parts of the world, people are using camel dung and cow dung to heat their homes, to cook their meals. And we look at that like, oh, that's nasty. But this is life. And here, according to whatever apparatus you have, you're going to burn the fuel that you have. So you have this apparatus. So how it works for us is that we have all the apparatus. We have all of these different. If you have electric heat in your ceiling and you have forced air unit with gas, but then you also have a propane heater over here, and then you have an electric heater over here, but then you also have a wood stove over here, what are you going to use to heat your house? Well, whichever you have fuel for. What we have fuel for in our waking state of sleep is formatory apparatus. The formatory part of the intellectual center. Well, that's great. Except the problem with the formatory part of the intellectual center is it only can do two things. It can say yes or no. That's it. That's the extent of its wisdom. That's the extent of its ability. It can say yes or no. It can't even say yes and no. It can't even think like that. There's no way that it can think yes and no. Yes and no? That doesn't work. Yes is an opposite of no. You can't take two opposites and make them one. That's not the way it works. So it can't even think like that. You see by this example that what we call thinking isn't even thinking. All it is just swinging back and forth like a pendulum. In the formatory part of our thinking, our whole outlook is expressed only in yes or no. That doesn't mean that all that we can do is think in yes or no. It means that all we can do is see in yes or no. We can't even let things come into us. They can't even come into us and fall on us in any place other than yes or no. Why is the whole world divided into opposites? Okay, they just hung Saddam Hussein. How many people think that was a good idea? Yes or no? It was a good idea. See, nobody's going to say anything here. Because you know I'm waiting to pounce on you. But you see that the whole world is split on this issue. You see that, don't you? I mean, you are aware enough of the world to know that they are split on this issue. Some people say, yes, absolutely. Kill them all. Let God sort them out. And other people say, you know, that's just wrong. We just shouldn't be doing that. How can we ever expect to have, I even read this, how can we ever expect to have world peace if we keep agitating people with these kinds of actions? And someone else said, well, you can't expect to have world peace because of anything that's going to happen in the world. It's got to happen inside of you. Which, of course, is a very astute observation. And all of our astute observations get us almost nowhere, really, when you think about it, because we don't know what to do with them. We just observe something. Oh, well, that's that. Yeah, I see that. Then we're satisfied that we've observed it and that that is all we need to do, which is not the case. Higher centers work in terms of yes and no. Our ordinary thinking, our decisions that we trust and that we follow so much, they have nothing to do with real thinking because of this severe limitation of yes or no. There's no middle ground. There's nothing except this or that, the two opposites. So it's a huge limitation when you consider that this wall is yes and that wall is no and nothing exists between, which means we don't exist unless we get on this wall or get on that wall. Then we exist. And that's how life is for us. People don't exist until they're on one of those walls. Yes or no. Democrat or Republican. Liberal or conservative. Dove or hawk. For or against. Yes or no. Good or bad. Right or wrong. Up or down. Hot or cold. This is where we live. Because of the fuel that we burn. Formatory part of the intellectual center works with the exclusion of one side and the affirmation of the other, the opposite side, or vice versa. Because of this, our whole world is divided into opposite camps. The formatory part of the mind, this work says, is third force blind. It's always swinging between opposites, yes or no, and it has no neutralizing force, no yes and no, no harmonizing force. Yes and no is a harmonizing force. Well, let's take the example of Saddam Hussein, who was recently hung for crimes against humanity, whatever. Some people didn't even know where this happened. Well, where did this happen? Did it happen in the United States? No, it happened in Iraq. Oh, well, then it has nothing to do with us. It has something to do with us. We are the power behind things that are happening in Iraq. What does that mean? That we are the power behind things that are happening in Iraq? Yes, that's exactly what that means. Well, what about what the Iraqis are doing? What about all the things that the terrorists and the rebels are doing? Well, what about it? Would they be doing that if we weren't there? Are they not reacting to us? Are we not reacting to them? Is it not one big cluster of reactions totally out of control now, where we couldn't stop this. You can see there's no way we could stop this now. We have not got the consciousness on this planet to wake up enough to make enough effort to be willing to compromise and be wrong, to be willing to find some middle ground. It's impossible now. It cannot happen. And the proof of that is it will not happen. Now, I hate to be right about this. History proves me so right. This is the way it works. This is the way it has always worked. This is the way it always will work. Because this is the way that this ray of creation functions mechanically. No harmonizing force. Active and passive forces are mutually destructive, and we don't understand this. They are mutually destructive. Whether it's active force or passive force, it still has the same effect. They are mutually destructive. Neutralizing force, the third force, is a relating force. It takes from the active force and it takes from the passive force, from both sides of any question, and it brings them into a new relation, a synthesis, and yet is neither of them. It's not the active, it's not the passive, but it partakes of both of them and it makes something new. Can you see that this whole situation cannot change unless something new happens? Unless there is a third force introduced. Look at that third force. Well, let's just be wild and imagine something. Okay, we're attacked by aliens in spaceships from another galaxy. What would happen in Iraq? Screw that! Survival of the planet. If mankind is going to survive, we have to join together to fight this enemy. Third force, neutralizing force, just came into it, and all of a sudden, all of our differences, like, well, they don't matter now. What matters now is this. If our children are going to survive, if we're going to survive, we need to join together, band together, and hopefully fight off this alien force that came to dominate our planet, to destroy us, and take our resources, and take our planet, because their world's dying. Whoa, okay, well, suddenly everything else just it pales in comparison. It's like having a splinter in your thumb and it abscesses, you know, and it's like, oh man, it's just like throbbing and it's your whole life is about your thumb. You've been there, right? Mm-hmm. Or your finger, whatever. You've been there. And it's like, oh man, oh, I can't remember what this was, what life was like without this throbbing, this constant pain, this heat. You know, every time I bump it, it's like, oh, I want to make it go away. Then all of a sudden, you're messing around with something and you're not paying attention and you cut your thumb off. Well, forget about that little splinter. It's all over now. Who cares about that? There's only one thing important to you now. I cut my thumb off. I got to get to the emergency room. Maybe they can sew it back on. But it's worthless. It's throbbing. Forget it. I'll sew it back on anyway. I'll deal with the rest of that later. You get my drift? And this is a third force. Now, it's an extreme example, but we're thick and coarse and slow. We're burlap people. We're burlap scarecrows. I invented that. Practically, we make an aim at one swing of the pendulum or the other swing of the pendulum, and we can't keep it. Or we're surprised to see that it has awakened the opposite side. Jordan makes a name. I'm not going to eat unconsciously. I'm going to eat consciously. And then all of a sudden, shocked to realize that it has awakened the other side. Screw that! I'm going to do what I want! Well, there goes that aim out the window. And it's always such a shock to us. It's like, where did that come from? It came from making aim. It's called second force. You have the active force. I made the aim. Now you have the resisting force. It says no. Because the aim has been made without the calculation of second force, the force of resistance, we're blindsided by it. We've got to learn coarsely at first that we can't do. And this is how we learn. We learn it in very coarse burlap sandpaper ways. We learn it because we're thick and slow. Things have to come to us with great, huge baseball bats. We don't get the finer breezes that blow. We have to be hit on the head.
Huh? Oh, okay. I guess that's the wrong way.
See, we're slow, we're thick, because we're using this heavy, slow fuel. Whereas higher centers are quick, they're very fast. Let's look at it another way. Let's look at the pendulum. Swing over here. Here's the pendulum over here. Oh, and it stops up here. It's nice and slow up here. Coming up from center all the way up. It's slowing down, slowing down, slowing down, slowing, slowing, slowing until it finally just stops. And it's poised here, motionless for a moment. And then it starts back down. And does it start real fast? No, it starts slowly. Slowly, slowly, picking up speed until it gets to the center. It whizzes across the center with the highest speed that it has. And then it starts slowing, 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 slowing. And it stops at this side. And then it slowly starts to fall back down. But it picks up speed and it goes whizzing across the center again. Well, the whizzing across the center we miss because we don't have a fast enough center to see that. to catch that action. But we can catch it up here and up here. It's like hummingbird wings, people. You don't have what it takes to see them going however many beats per second. But through slow motion photography, we have been able to see and count how many times a hummingbird will flap its wings in a second, which is like phenomenal. We go, whoa. Fortunately, we have computers that can count it for us so we don't have to sit there and make any effort. Because what will we do? We'd have our effort. 1, 2, 3. Ugh, I need a drink. 4, 5, 6. Oh, this is making my head hurt. 7, 8, 9. Wow, this is the longest second I've ever seen. 10, 11, 12. So we learn coarsely at first that we can't do, that we need help. The formatory part divides everything into yes or no, effectively dissecting the very life out of the help that we could receive from higher centers, which operates only in yes and no. Because it has this middle that we can't see. It is fast enough, quick enough in consciousness and perception to be able to see the middle just fine. It can hang out in the middle like we could hang out on the ends. If you're fast enough, the middle is slow. Have you ever seen a frog snag a fly with its tongue? Again, they have to have slow-mo photography. The mouth opens, the tongue comes out, unravels, unfurls, whap, with some kind of like glue, snags the fly, rolls back up, and the mouth closes. And it all happens so fast that you can't blink your eye in the time it happens. We're so slow. But not everything in life is that slow. Some things are operating at higher speeds because they're using different fuels. Frog's not going to last as long as you last. They burn out pretty fast. But trees last a lot longer than you. Of course, trees can't move from one room to another as quickly as you can either. You start to get the idea, I hope. What can we do? Gradually, we can dissuade ourselves from following the suggested solutions which arise at one or the other of the full swings of the pendulum. And you're over here. I'll never speak to her again. Okay, well, that's the suggestion you get from that side of the pendulum. What's over at the other side?
Oh, I just love her so much. I'm going to forgive her for everything she did.
Okay, that's that suggestion from that side. Now, let's say you've lived long enough with this person to know that, well, you're not going to do this because you tried that and that didn't work. Because when you were over here, you just loved her so much. But then you're over here, you were never going to speak to her again. Then you're over here, and it's like, oh, but I have to. And then you're over here, but I hate her. And then you're over here, but I love her. No middle. Just those two extremes. So we can start to dissuade ourselves from listening to that. It's like, okay, yes, I know what you're going to say. You're going to say this, and you're going to say this. You're going to say this, and you're going to say the opposite. Okay, so just that in and of itself, dissuading yourself from listening to or from making a decision on either side, begin to distrust the range of thoughts and feelings belonging to these swings. Begin to distrust all of the thoughts and feelings you have over here where I'm going to forgive her, and everything will be fine, and we'll live happily ever after.
Mm-hmm.
I hate her. She should burn in hell forever.
Over here on this side.
I feel it in my bones.
I'm sure you do. Begin to distrust them. They're not faithful. They faithfully will say the same thing over and over again. But they're meaningless when it comes to anything that can help you to have a life, a real conscious life, a genuine life that will lead you out of this insanity in which we live, out of this world of opposites, out of this world of kill them all. Oh, no, make peace with the whole world. Neither one is going to happen. Well, then, unless we accidentally kill ourselves, which is highly likely. They say that it's like the number 3 way that we can destroy ourselves is atomic bombs. You know, it's an accident is what it would be, is an accident. There are enough nuclear weapons still on the planet that right now, if somebody pushed a button and accidentally sent missiles, we have no defense against them. We have no way to stop them. The only thing that we can do is retaliate. We're not retaliate. And all of the scenarios that they've worked out all prove that we would retaliate, and they would retaliate. Therefore, we would launch enough nuclear missiles to destroy the population of the Earth 8 times over. Talk about overkill. 8 times over. Now, that is this kind of thinking at both ends, you see, either or. Well, what are our choices? Well, we either let them destroy us or we retaliate. But it has the same effect. You destroy everything. Well, yes, but that's what we're going to do because that's our only choice. With hydrogen 48, that's our only choice. We have no other choices. There is, we can't even see it in the middle. We can't even see anything else. We can't even see any relating force. We can't see it. It doesn't exist for us. You can see it doesn't exist for our planet, sadly. Because the formatory part divides everything into yes or no, effectively ruining anything that could bring about some kind of relationship between the two opposites. Begin to dislike the coarse division the coarse language, the violent solutions to our problems that are suggested by this swing of the pendulum or that swing of the pendulum. Begin to see the useless solutions that they offer and begin to develop a taste for the finer adjustments that have to be made to the pendulum in order to get it more toward the middle. You can understand that the finer adjustments need to be made in our way of thinking. We've got to stop thinking yes and no. We've got to start thinking of bringing things together. We've got to start doing this in ourselves. I'm not talking about the world. I'm talking about in ourselves. I'm not here to change the world. I'm here to change my own level of being. And if you can get something from that, as I am in the process of doing that, hurrah for you and for me, because it will benefit us both. And if we do it, the people in this room, it will alter something in the world. Something in the world has to change. Now, how much, I don't know. And I don't really care that. That's not my goal. That's not my aim. And if that happens, that's great. Through self-observation, we increase consciousness of ourselves. Ooh, wow. What a concept. Yes, through self-observation, we increase consciousness of ourselves. So self-observation is a lot like, this is Parkinson right here. This thing is Parkinson. Self-observation means I get to walk around this thing called Parkinson and look at it. Ooh, he has no middle. He's got two sides, but no middle. Why is that? Well, because he lives on either side of the pendulum swing. But he doesn't live in the middle because he has no middle. It's just nothing there or vacant, just like all the rest of us donut people. I walk around it, and I can see things about it that I could not see when I am it.
What do you mean no middle? Of course I have a middle. This is my middle. And so is this. And so is this.
So we begin to become more conscious of ourselves. And this light will help us to change our whole feeling, our whole idea of ourselves. When I can see these things about myself from over here, I start to change my idea of who I am and what I am, and of what I am capable. I start to accept a new reality, a reality that is more real and less imagination. False personality keeps us on one side of ourself. We don't see, know, or acknowledge the other side, and so we end up living in the wrong relation to ourselves because whatever side we're seeing, we're not seeing the other side. And so if we're over here, isn't it amazing when we love her and all we care about is just forgiving her and making peace with her? We forgot all about how much we hated her and all the grief it caused over here. And then we're over there, we forgot all about this. But with some relating force, something that could bring those two together and relate them, we could go, wait a second. Let's look at this in a new way. There's a third thing that arises then. That's what we're talking about. I'm talking about developing that in ourselves, some middle ground through this third force, by bringing the opposites together with a relating force, the relating force that can only come from better hydrogens, effort, being more awake, and struggling against our mechanical nature.